I received a response about the blog I did a few weeks ago about hell, which said that it helped to make logical sense of how hell could exist. But what didn't make any sense, what this person was really struggling to believe in, was the idea of a personal devil. Hell yes, the devil no. I've been a Christian for over 30 years now, but I've only come to believe in the devil in the last 10 or so. Driven to Christ by reason, the idea of a personal devil was something that I just couldn't bring myself to believe in. Rationally, it seemed like the idea of the devil was just a childish way to understand why people make evil choices, kind of like the cartoonish image of an angel on one shoulder and the devil on the other, each whispering into your ear, trying to twist your will to theirs. It's easy to dismiss the idea of a red-tided being whispering in your ear, trying to steal your soul away from God. What's worse, most of the people I knew who believed in a personal devil seemed to see him lurking around every corner. Not only did they blame him for the things they did wrong, the devil made me do it, but they blamed him for everything that was wrong in their lives and everything they saw that was broken in the world. And they couldn't seem to accept the unimaginable evil that we often see in our world, things like the Holocaust or genocide, without attributing it to some higher power that possessed people to do it. To me, it seemed obvious that those were just examples of man's inhumanity to man. But then, two of the smartest people I've ever read, Raymond Brown and C.S. Lewis, forced me to reconsider my Satan skepticism. Shockingly, both of these highly critical, highly intelligent, two of what I think are the smartest people to ever walk the face of the earth, these two men both believed in a personal devil, a real devil. And they didn't naively read him into everything. Instead, they presented a very sophisticated understanding of how and why he exists, an understanding that far transcended that red-tided image of the devil that was so easy to dismiss because it's so silly. Raymond Brown was the most revered Catholic scripture scholar of the 20th century, and he managed to do something that very few scholars are able to do. He garnered nearly the universal respect of his peers, Catholic and Protestant, believer and non-believer. He is considered by scholars to be one of the most balanced and soberly critical scholars to have ever lived. That's what attracted me to him in the first place. As a skeptic, I was drawn to him because with tremendous integrity, he wouldn't accept something unless it could be established through rigorous analysis. And then he would lay out the evidence in meticulous detail so that it was transparent for everybody to see. It's amazing, but for so many years, I read him without realizing he really believed in the devil. And once I found out he did, what I also realized is that he believed because of his scholarly analysis. C.S. Lewis was as brilliant and skeptical as they come. His path from atheism was based on the reasonableness of what he called mere Christianity. Being a professor of ancient literature, I always assumed when Lewis talked about the devil, he was speaking symbolically, metaphorically. So I was shocked to learn that when he was writing one of his most popular books, Screwtape Letters, which is an imaginary dialogue between a demon and his protege who are trying to trip up and steal the soul of this newly minted, newly converted Christian. It's a great book, you gotta get it, it's hysterical. But when he was writing that book, Lewis talked about how he felt that he was under spiritual attack. He felt the oppressive weight of a real personal devil opposing him. If anybody else said something like that, I would have found it laughable. So here are these two incredibly intelligent, incredibly critical scholars who believed in a personal devil. And they believed in a way that was sophisticated, that couldn't be dismissed as silly or simplistic. Since that time, I've discovered that there are many other academics, including a number of non-believers, who are now coming to the realization that the evil we experience in the world can't simply be explained by human intention or psychological causes. They're beginning to acknowledge that the evil we encounter in this world can't simply be explained as man's inhumanity to man. And they're now open and considering the idea of something very much like the devil, a personal devil, a supernatural force of evil. I'll go more into this in future blogs, and also kind of take off from Brown and Lewis to explain how the idea of a personal devil can make sense, can make logical sense. People say that the devil's biggest lie is to convince us that he doesn't exist. And that makes perfect sense. If the devil is real, then that would be one of his most effective tactics, is to get us to think that he doesn't exist. But that's not his biggest lie. His biggest lie is about God, about who God is and how he feels about us. His biggest lie is to get us to think that God doesn't really give a damn about us. If your life hasn't turned out the way you've wanted it to, and you are tempted to think that there may not be a God out there who loves you, that's a lie straight from the devil. If you think there may be a God out there, but that he couldn't possibly love you, he may love everybody else, but he couldn't possibly love somebody like you, that's a lie straight from the devil. If you feel invisible, insignificant, like you've been forgotten, and you're tempted to think that God has overlooked you somehow, that he's forgotten you, that's a lie straight from the devil. In Greek, the word for devil is diabolin, which simply means to throw apart or to separate. By definition, the devil is the one who separates or divides. If there really is a devil, then he is desperate to separate you from God forever. He is desperate to convince you with the lie that God couldn't possibly love you. Whatever else you believe, don't believe his lie. So what do you think? How do you make sense of the devil? How do you understand him? Why would God create such a being in the first place, or allow him to continue to exist? Or do you think this is all just ridiculous, that you categorically reject the idea of the devil? Let me know what you think. You can go to the Contact EJ page of the website, Raising Jesus website, and leave your comments there. Also, if you would like to see more videos like this, please like the Raising Jesus Facebook page so that we can keep you updated on future videos, blogs, and announcements. I would love to hear from you.